quite a bit of writing, some studies with Gini indicators and so forth that suggest that Japan is now a much more unequal society than it was before. It used to be seen as a relatively homogeneous, equal society. Now more unequal, now these pockets of it. Here's the other point of children's poverty, of a fifth of the kids before 3 years of school's age live in the low, in houses that make less than the poverty level. The whole syndrome of lower wages for women and lower wages for men who lost their job and then find part-time jobs and so forth. I believe these patterns of structural change and these syndromes of economic deprivation and poor situations go together. And what I suggest is that in addition to the very important debate between the two party leaderships and the debates that are presented to the public through the media, either initiated by the parties themselves or about the parties and so forth, the general public administration, public information about the two parties, that in addition to that kind of idea of an election, there are also other things going on. There is this culture of economic malaise, and also there is, which is hooked into social change, and there is also a decline in the machine politics that supported the LDP for so long. And I believe that machine politics, the LDP's machine efforts, have probably been weakening and not noticed, probably certainly noticed by those involved, but certainly it's not something I can report. So this is a comment on how to think about an election and how to understand the mechanics, the processes, what's going on in an electoral process. They aren't, except for the real heavy-duty machine politics part, they're not all that different from other places, and I don't pretend that they are. Now, as a second part of my brief comments, I'm really concerned about, and this comes out of a book that the PHP group in Japan is publishing called Can Japan Survive? Japan has some things to do, whoever leads, and hopefully they'll be done competently. And I'm going to enumerate these very slowly, and really, I won't try to predict things that would be foolish, but these could be called challenges. A lot of people would call them challenges. Japan's aging society. We've all heard about it. But Japan is aging faster than any other rich, developed society. And there are all kinds of scare statistics, and I have them one of them on my notes, but something like 30% of the population are above 55, perhaps. Anyhow, they're heavy-duty statistics. What can be done in the face of all of this, or what needs do I have? Japan has a very developed medical system and medical insurance for workers and medical insurance for the general population, and it doesn't have a lot of nursing homes. It does have a lot of examples, I've seen statistical examples that of X million young women left their jobs to take care of parents at home who were aging and sick and so forth. But the aging society will continue aging. It has started the same time that the young groups have in society have virtually no savings, and you know, what private individuals will be able to do is unclear, and the government itself is heroically in debt. Right now, 180 to 190% relative to current GDP. In other words, the government is owes 180 or 190% of the amount of current GDP. And this is the national government. If you toss in the local government, which is heavily involved in providing medical services and welfare services, there is 20 or 30%. And I saw one prediction in a recent Economist that said Japan would have a national debt that would be 250% of GDP in 30 years, 35 years, perhaps. Anyhow, not before very long. So, this is a challenge for the DPG. It was a very big challenge, it would have been, for the ODP. Secondly, industries are changing in Japan. We all know how well the automobile industry has done in Japan. We've had some representatives of the Japanese automobile ministry, industry here today. We also know that there's been a great deal of offshoring. Some of it started right here in Honda with the building of the Honda motorcycle factory, and then soon after that, an automobile factory. And offshoring, you know, examples of this, you know, the moving of processes, industrial processes that would have been conducted in the past in Japan, offshoring is going on in Asia. In China, Japanese automobile industry. The electronics industry, and one always looks to these two industries, well, it's the most internationally advanced, competitive, active, and so on, industries. That industry is now becoming modularized. Meaning, if I understand correctly, the production of different components in different places, so that Japanese makers are now, well, some makers are aligned with others within Japan. Seven of the electronics companies went together and put together a production process called Elpida a few years ago. But now they're working with counterparts in Taiwan, counterparts in South Korea, even some in China, and also counterparts in Southeast Asia. So there's this globalization process that is going on, and just how any Japanese government can, you know, keep up with the need for job creation in the face of these kinds of forces, and also the other forces that are causing losses of jobs, you know, is going to be a big challenge, just a giant challenge. One thing that and this is very closely related, and it's jumping subjects just a little bit, but the DPJ, the Democratic Party of Japan, talks a lot about stopping the emphasis on exports because it's the drop in exports to the U.S. that causes so many problems, and let's stress consumption, and, you know, first consumption assumes jobs, and then, you know, the jobs have to be there, and we'll leave that right there, but question in my mind, I looked at the latest import information, and 80% of what Japan imports consists of fuel, metals, raw materials, food. Now, Japan, this is the kind of thing that you read when you read a basic economic geography book. Japan is a country that's almost without resources other than people. No resources. We should have mentioned then, well, we did say fuel, and that includes not only oil, but gas that's been brought in from other places. How do you pay for imports? Maybe I'm wrong. I'm not sure of these things, but then I look at the figures and I think, I guess, exports. You know, the world's changing so much that people are old like me, you know, you think maybe there's something new that I haven't heard about. But for the moment, let's suggest that maybe the DPJ is off on the wrong foot to talk about it, if I understand this, to talk about too much emphasis on exports, because it seems to me they're absolutely essential.